firstly, you're all very welcome to this event today. We're delighted to be hosting it. The Irish Women Workers Union had decided to commemorate the 110th year. As you know, the 100th anniversary, we erected the plaque on Liberty Hall commemorating the Women Workers Union, and Padraigina Murucu, who was the last General Secretary, attended that. Unfortunately, Padraigina is no longer with us, but she is commemorated in the Left Lives Four book. I want to introduce you now to Ethel Buckley, who is the Deputy General Secretary of SIPTU, and she's also a member of the Communist Executive and a formerly an Equality Officer, but more importantly, she's also a member of the Irish Women Workers Union Committee.
Thanks very much, Mags, and thanks so much for inviting me to be here today. And on behalf of SIPTU, I want to thank the committee for organising today's events. As you said, I'm a member of the committee myself, and within SIPTU, as you know, the Irish Women Workers Union amalgamated into the Federated Workers Union of Ireland, which was one of the unions that merged to form SIPTU. So we are really proud of the Women Workers Union legacy within our union, and we're really committed to keeping the memory of the Women Workers Union alive. And as you said, Mags, we had a great centenary celebration with Padraigine, and we were just really anxious, and we're delighted to participate in this 110th commemoration. And I suppose it just really strikes me that we're, as women in the trade union movement, we're really standing on the shoulders of giants, the people who established the Women Workers Union, like Louis Bennett, like Helen Shenevics, like Helena Maloney, are true role models for all of us women who try to continue in their tradition today. And I'm really excited later on today to talk about your new book, Mags, and your book about some of the other women who have made an inspiring and amazing contribution to this tradition of radical women, radical feminist politics, and to trade union politics. And I suppose to say as well that we are commemorating a tradition, but we're also trying to keep that legacy active and alive. And it is a very interesting time, an active time really, for women's equality in the workplace and in society generally. So I suppose most notably during the COVID lockdown, it is really women who have borne the brunt of the working from home pressures of caring and combining caring and paid work outside the home. And we have really heard that very strongly from our women members in particular in SIPTU. It's also a very exciting time though, because after generations, decades, and literally generations, right back to the start and the establishment of the Women Workers Union, we have legislation now around gender pay transparency. And we're very committed in SIPTU and across the trade union movement, working with the Irish Congress of Trade Unions, to build our capacity within the trade union movement to put equality and equal pay issues and shrinking the gender pay gap on the collective bargaining agenda, right centrally into the collective bargaining agenda of unions. So it's not an add-on, it's not something that negotiators think of at the end of a negotiation. So that's exciting to see that finally come to pass, and to try to make improvements for women's pay around that legislation. I suppose another thing that's very exciting at the moment is that we had the Citizens Assembly on gender equality. The trade union movement was centrally involved in making arguments for the improvement of women's rights in the workplace, but also general societal rights. And we achieved almost all that we had set out to achieve with the citizens, but very notably actually, a recommendation from the citizens that workers in Ireland would have the right to, legal right to engage in collective bargaining with their employers, which is a right, as you know, Mags, is denied almost uniquely to workers in Ireland, uniquely in the European Union. So that was one great outcome, and a lot of other great recommendations around women's pay and childcare issues. And as you know, organising childcare workers and improving childcare provision, but particularly public provision in Ireland, has been a long-standing demand and campaign of the trade union movement. And I know you were particularly excited about this yourself, Mags. I know I was, that just before the lockdown, one of the last trade union public events was the enormous march of childcare workers through Dublin City to coincide with the 2020 general election. 30,000 childcare workers and their supporters marched on the Dáil that day, demanding better jobs for childcare workers and better provision of publicly funded, quality, affordable childcare in Ireland. Because, as you know, women's work will continue to suffer as long as we don't have the provision of adequate publicly funded childcare in this country. And so that's exciting. And also exciting is that arising out of that campaign, the Sip Too Big Start campaign, we now have a joint Labour committee established for childcare workers. And we're about to sit down and negotiate across from the employers a new set of terms and conditions for childcare workers. And I suppose really in the tradition of the Women Workers Union, it is childcare workers themselves that will lead that negotiation. They have been elected by their peers, and they will go in and lead those negotiations. And just, and I think you're going to be talking to Maureen Johnson later. And I know that Maureen, along with a number of other women that you and others write about in your book, Mags, the childcare issue, they rightfully identified that as a key issue that we needed to address in Ireland. And then just finally, to say we were delighted in SIP2, great week last week when we finally saw equal pay achieved by the women's football team. The women's football team, who organised into the Professional Footballers Association of Ireland, which is an affiliate of SIP2 back in 2017, are inspirational to all of us, I think. I was honoured to be with them in Liberty Hall the day that they announced that they had unionised, and the day that they threatened strike action over the, disrespectful treatment of them, particularly around provision of kit and all of that. But those women have really led the way, and I know that they have been congratulated by women's sports people all over the world for what they have achieved there in just a short time, really, 4 or 5 years. So fair play to them for that. And just final thing about your book, Mags, which we'll be talking about again later, and I just love it so much, but for people who read the chapter on Evelyn Owens, I just thought that Evelyn Owens, as a football fan, and would have just been really delighted to see that announcement last week of equal pay in that space. So, Mags, thanks again to the fellow committee members for all their work in organising this event. I know there's loads of SIP2 members around the country, and I'm sure from other trade unions as well, watching the event. And I hope everyone really, really enjoys it.
Oh, finally, musing and unmusing. It's the saga of the times, isn't it? Thanks for that, Ethel. Much appreciated. And yeah, we are all delighted about the footballers, and it's about time too. Again, it's that thing about women being in the background. And for the next segment here, I want to introduce somebody who's talking about another woman that was in the background. And, you know, the fact that there was no bridge named after a woman in Dublin really shows the reality of where we are. So I want to introduce my good friend Catherine Ann Cullen, who is the resident poet of Poetry Ireland at the moment, and she's going to talk to us about Rosie.
Thanks, Mags. And huge congratulations, Mags, on your book. I realized that in the invitation for this event, it doesn't even mention who the author of the book is. You're just too modest altogether. So huge congratulations. I'm really looking forward to reading it. So this is a sonnet that I wrote, so it's quite nice and short, about the bridge and it being named after Rosie. And it was a great campaign. Well done. I know lots of people who were involved in it are here today. I'm so delighted that Rosie got a bridge named after her. So this is called Naming a Bridge. To make a bridge, you first must see the gap. Then fling yourself full length across the space, like Rosie Hackett did for 60 years, the factory girl who did not know her place. Ah, Rosie knew that place and all its wrongs. The 60-hour week on the factory floor, the union badge that barred her from her work, the strike turned back upon the locked out poor. Her life's three struggles forged one steely frame, the fight for women, workers, and the plough. She raised a rebel banner from a roof. For workers' holidays, she raised a row. A name so nearly lost, now set in stone. To name this bridge reclaims her for her own. Thank you.
Catherine, that was lovely. Thank you so much for that. And now I want to introduce the next piece is a conversation with Maureen Johnson. And I just think it's very appropriate that she comes after Rosie because she's another one of those rebel women. And she also worked in Jacobs at some stage as well as Rosie did before she worked in Liberty Hall. And so I don't think Maureen needs introduction for any of the more seniors, let's say, of us. But, you know, for younger people, I think this video is really important because I think that people should know the struggles that went on before and, you know, the achievements of people like Maureen. So thanks for that.
I'm here with Maureen Johnson and want to talk to Maureen about you growing up in the Liberties. What was it like? What was the hardship, but also what was the camaraderie?
Well, I loved living in Pimlico because the people were so nice and they were very close. They were like one big family, and the street itself was like a village. There were even little cottages around with thatched roofs, and but we lived in a tenement house. And on the far side of the street from us, there were the artisans' dwellings. There was no kind of difference in attitude. You know, the people mixed around very well. Most of the people in the artisans' dwellings would have been people who had some sort of an association with the British government, because the artisans' dwellings were started by the Earl of Mead's wife, the 12th Earl. And there were only six tenement houses where I lived, and down on the banks of Pimlico, which we called where the River Poddle passed by, and where my granny and all her neighbours used to do the washing. That's why I called the book that I wrote On the Banks of Pimlico. They mixed very well, the people, and there was no kind of social difference between them, you know, except that the people in the artisans' dwellings would have had jobs, because they couldn't have got an artisan's dwelling without having a job. Whereas the people in the tenement houses were mostly casual workers and that. They didn't have, some of them were mostly unemployed and were never employed. But the people were very good to each other and they helped each other an awful lot. In sickness or anything like that, they were like a social group, you know, you could, if you want, were looking for something, if you wanted anything, there was always, oh, go down to Mrs. So-and-so and she'll tell you where, you know, how to get out of that situation, or she knows somebody, or there was always somebody there to help. And so I don't remember people being, you know, isolated in the same way as they are, and they were when those people were moved out to the corporation houses. They felt very isolated and very alone, and they didn't have all the facilities, if you can call them such, that we had in Pimlico. You know, there were all sorts of little shops with knickknacks in them, and sweet shops, dairy shops. There were all the shops, everything you wanted was there. You know, you didn't have to go into town. There were no big places like Woody's or any of these places. But the poverty was really bad, especially among the people that are on the, in the tenements. My mother was a widow, and my three brothers were had emigrated to England during the Second World War. I was 8 years old when that started, and I was left alone with my mother. We had one room. The people were very nice and very helpful towards each other, and it was a very close community, and my granny used, just around the corner of Pimlico when my granny was young, they used to do the washing on the banks of Pimlico, and that's why I called the book Around the Banks of Pimlico, because that's where all the women used to congregate, and they'd be doing the washing there in the River Puddle. And I have to tell you that it wasn't a very clean river, because it came down Marrowbone Lane, and in Marrowbone Lane there were all sorts of factories and animal skin factories and that sort of thing, you know, and everything would be thrown into the River Puddle. But it's still, there was no other way of washing clothes, you know. No such thing as washing machines or anything. We didn't even have proper water running. You know, there was a tap in the back of the tenements. One tap for the whole house, you know. But anyway, that's the way it was. The people were very good to each other. And when any of the women were having babies and all like that, I mean, if there were other children in the family, they were taken in by the neighbours and that, and kept. If there was a baby being born at home, maybe no room in the Coon Hospital for them, they'd, and maybe the women just, some of them preferred to have the children at home. So they would, you know, so-and-so would have Biddy and Mary and that. They'd be distributed among the people, you know. They'd stay there with them for about a week and then they'd go back home again, you know. So they were like that, very good. And if one person had too much of something, you gave it to somebody who hadn't got any, you know. And that was very difficult for people when they were moved out of Pimlico, when there was a compulsory purchase order put on the tenement houses, because they were going to build around Dublin, a circular road they were going to build all around Dublin. And this, our houses were in the way. And that road, now that was in 1940s, and that road hasn't been built yet. And there's no talk of it now at the moment at all. But on the site where our house was, at the corner of Marrowbone Lane and Thomas Court Bawn and Pimlico, there were three intersections there. It's just a waste ground, just wasteland, you know.
Tell us, Maureen, your mother was a widow, and how were things then? Because it was difficult.
Well, you see, before my brothers went away to England, we were really very, very poor, because one of them had a messenger boy's job, and another was working in the Wicklow Hotel as the little fella that goes around buttons, you know. And the next fellow was still at school at that stage, but there was no big money coming in, you know. So that when they went away to England during the war, they sent money home. And I have to say that we were never as well off in our lives as we were then, because there was three of them sending money home, and there was only me at home and my mother, you know, but they were very good to her, you know. And that was the way it was, an awful lot of people. The amount of money that was sent from England during the war to help the unemployed people, because there was no work, there was no jobs. And even if you had a job, the wages were appalling, absolutely.
And tell us, Maureen, then, to come on to you then going into work, what age were you and what were you paid and what were the conditions like?
Well, when I came to 14, I left school the day I was 14. And my mother said, now you'll have to go out every morning and look for work. And that's what you had to do. You had to go out looking. You had to go around all the factories saying, any vacancies, please? And sometimes they just tell you to buzz off, and sometimes you'd say to them, will you take my name, and if anything comes up, will you send, you know? And they'd say yes, and they'd take your name with no intentions of ever getting in touch. But I think I was about 3 or 4 days going around different factories. There were lots of back lane factories. Some of these factories were actually in tenement houses where there was people were living in the tenement houses, and there was factories. Over on the north side, in the lots, that part behind the Liffey, you know, their Bachelor's Walk and that, I went into factories that were in tenement houses, and I couldn't believe it. And when I told my mother, she thought, God almighty, that's terrible. I mean, if there was a fire, because it could happen where there's a lot of electricity and machinery and that, you know. But the conditions of pay and work, you know, and pay was appalling. It was very, very bad. My first job I got in a glove factory in Bonham Street, and it was hand stitching men's sheepskin gloves, and they were hand stitched. And my wages were 6 and 11 pence a week. I remember that. Not even 7 shillings, but 6 shillings and 11 pence. That was very little. And if anybody wants to try and translate that into what the pay is today, you know. I lasted in that job 6 weeks. And then I was sacked. I wasn't told I was sacked until what was said to me first was, we haven't enough work, so we'll send for you when enough comes up again. Now, this place in Bonham Street was it had been a pigsty, and Bonham is a baby pig. It's the Irish for a baby pig. And It had been transformed and done up a little bit, you know, cleaned out. It wasn't dirty or anything like that. And but it was turned into a factory, but it had been a pigsty. And there were about 12 girls working in it. And I don't know what wages each of them got, but they were on piecework. The amount of, you know, you got paid so much for a glove, you know. Now, I didn't know how to make a glove, but they were showing me how to do it, you know. But my job at the time was providing them with threads and cleaning the floor, like the way you see young girls sweeping the floor in a hairdresser's, you know. And my mother said, sure, it's only a start. Once they know that you've had a job, you know, you'll get a job. But anyway, I was told that they didn't need me after 6 weeks, and they would send for me. So 7 weeks and 8 weeks and 9 weeks passed, no sign of them sending for me. And then there was this young, oh, she was younger than me, a young kid, Sarah was her name, and she came up to the house one day, and she was looking for me to see how I was. And she said, you know, you're sacked. And that was the first time I realised that I was sacked. And I said, no, I'm not sacked. They're going to send for me. She said, no, they're not. She said, you're sacked, she said, for robbing a penny. And I said, I didn't rob any a penny. You did, you robbed a penny on so-and-so. It was our bus fare home, and you stole it. And that's what they said. She said, and I said, but I didn't steal any pennies there. I said, I didn't, I wouldn't. I said, what would I be bothered robbing a penny for? And she said, I know you didn't do it. And I said, why, how do you know? She said, because I robbed it. So that was that. I was beginning to learn what life was all about. It wasn't like school days. It was going to be very tough. So I didn't go, I didn't get a job, and I was in, somebody said to me, why don't you register with the Labour Exchange, as it was called then, and they might, if they have jobs, they will send you out. So I did that, and the Women's Labour Exchange was in Beresford Place. And the boys were also little boys, and that labour exchange was for unemployed women and little boys. That was the way it was, that's what it was called. And it was just another way, like putting you down, you know. So anyway, I went to the labour exchange, and the girl took all my everything about. She said, why, would you not like to go to the day junior technical school? And I said, what's that? So she said, well, she said, when you leave school, she said, and you're not working, she said, you can get an allowance if you go to school and stay at school for about a year, I think it was. So I went to the day junior technical school in Parnell Square, which is now the Writers' Union, right beside the church there, you know. And I loved it. It was very good, you know. The thing about it was that they were supposed to teach you a trade, a bit of a trade as well, how to use a sewing machine. But the sewing machines that they showed you how to use were foot machines. Whereas if you went into a factory, there were pedal machines, you know. There were, one was a press down, but, you know, you'd have it at home, that sort of machine. But I went there and I loved it. It was very good, and I met a lot of very interesting people, you know, girls from different parts of the country, which I didn't even know existed, you know. And I was there for a year, and then one day a friend of mine said she had a job in a shirt factory in Francis Street, and she lived near Francis Street. So she said, the forewoman was asking me, did I know anybody who, some little girl, a nice little girl, who would come across and do a bit of work. And she said, I thought of you. She said, we'll have a bit of gas. So I went down and I got the job in the factory. And I was there for over 2 years. But it wasn't... it wasn't unionised, and the wages were very bad. That was 9 and 11 pence a week.
And what were the hours for that, Maureen?
The hours were from 9 in the morning until 6 in the evening, and you got an hour for your lunch. So we, since everybody around lived near, you know, we could all go for our lunch, whatever, back home. And the work was quite hard. You had to, the women were on, what do you call it, the time?
Piecework.
And I found it very difficult because the noise was incredible, the noise of the machines. And the thing about it was it was difficult to earn enough in the week because the machines were always breaking down. And if you were on piecework, you had to wait until they sent out for a mechanic to come in and mend the machine. And you're just sitting there, you're at work, but you're not getting paid. You're not paid, and it's not your fault that the machine is broken. And that was something that I found that I couldn't take it at all. And my mother would say, well, why don't you start a union, you know? And I hadn't a clue. I mean, 15 years of age, I came to how you start a union. And I remember going around asking the various women, and they went, oh, a union, she must be a communist. She must be. To be in a union was to be very aggressive, and for women especially, union was for men, you know.
So tell us, the men working in the factory.
There was a cutter and his son, and he was an apprentice. And there was only the bosses then, like the men and the two men, I think they had they owned the factory, and their wives, one wife. Oh, not in this particular factory, sorry, that was in another factory, but in the one in Francis Street, that was owned by, what was the name? I'll think of it in a minute, but that was owned by a Protestant firm, and there was a forewoman in it, and she was from Derry because they made shirts in Derry, and she was very familiar with shirts and factories, and she was a holy terror. But she was a Catholic working for a Protestant firm, and she would kowtow to them. It was dreadful the way she kind of nearly genuflected in front of the boss, you know. So I asked a few of the women, would they join a union? And they were, oh, God almighty, you know. How do you mean? You're only 15, you know. What would you know? And, but in the end, I went down to the union, and Helen Chenevics was there, and... Louis Bennett, yeah. Down to the Women Workers Union in Fleet Street, yeah. And I remember when I was 15, I looked about 10. And I was very skinny. And I remember going in and saying I wanted to speak to Miss Bennett, Miss Louis Bennett, or Miss Chenevics. And my mother had told me the names of them, you see. So I went into them and I said, I want to start a union in my factory. And they listened to me, and I thought that they were looking at each other as much as to say, what are we going to do at her, you know, kind of thing. So in the end they said, is there anybody older than you in the factory? And I said, yes, there are lots of people, you know. And do they all agree to join the union? And I said, no. There's only one or two of them, and the one or two would be my age. But and they said, well, we'd really want to have the consent of all the women in the union before we could do anything. So that was the end of me trying to start a union at 15 years of age, not knowing anything about a union even, you know. I knew, like, that my brothers and all my family, my uncles and all like that, they were all trade unionists, very active, and my mother was a very good trade unionist. She worked in Jacobs, and she came out during the lockout, and they wouldn't take her back because she wouldn't take her badge off, you know. So she lost her job in Jacobs. So somebody had told the forewoman that I was trying to form a union, and I was sacked. So there I was, unemployed again.
There seems to be a pattern here, doesn't it?
Oh, geez, my life of failures and trying to start off, trying to start organisations that always ended.
That brings me on, Maureen. We were talking about when you were involved with the Irish Women's Liberation Movement, you realised that women needed childcare in order to be able to participate in politics and in trade unions and whatever.
Yeah.
So maybe you could talk to us a little bit about that.
Well, things progressed anyway. Time passed, and eventually I said, I'll have to do something about women, you know. It's all very well, all these politics, but women, no matter who they are, were downtrodden, and that was it. So I was married at this stage, and I had been in the Communist Party, and I'd learned a little bit about organisation. See, that was the thing about me trying to start the union. I knew nothing about organisation, absolutely nothing. But as time went on, I joined different organisations and I learned little bits, and, you know. By the time, anyway, at the time I had actually joined the Labour Party. I was in the Labour Party, and I found the Labour Party very good, in fact, for my branch of the Labour Party anyway. They didn't stop women from having, they encouraged women as much as they could, because I think a whole lot of them were really socialist minded, you know. They were not just Labour Party or trade unionists, they had an idea of changing society. So I learned a lot then, and I met a lot of people along the way, a lot of women who were also active in other organisations, and we used to meet and we'd be talking, and eventually, like, it was wages and all the things that, all the problems that face women, we used to talk about. And somebody said, why don't we do something about it? And then it so happened that the Women's Liberation Movement in America had just started up, and it was, the news was coming all over the world about these women who were joining together, you know. And of course the emphasis was on bra burning women, when that wasn't what it was about at all. But however, I had met Maureen de Burka, who was in Sinn Féin at the time, and people out of the Irish Times who were through the Labour Party. I met Mary Marr and a few others who were involved in different ways in writing about women. And showing up, like it was only beginning, women's pages in newspapers was only beginning to have a women's new page. God almighty, for women, what was we writing about? Baking and stitching and darning socks or something. But anyway, Maureen de Bourke, through her involvement in politics, she was in Sinn Féin, she had been approached by, she was contacted by some American women who were coming to Ireland to see what the situation in Ireland was like. And they got in touch with Maureen de Bourke, and then Maureen de Bourke got in touch with a number of people, including myself, who we knew each other, and we knew that we were interested in this. At the same time, the government had got, through trade unions, various women who were already organised in trade unions, they'd begun to think about the position of women and the status of women in Ireland, and they set up a committee on the status of women. And it was they had all the facilities, because through the civil service they got different organisations to do write up and tell them exactly what the position was, what wages were, and in comparison with men, and what the kind of work that women could do, and the opportunities that women didn't have as well, you know, that they could have done with. And also, you know, the Article 42, was it, of the Constitution, because of our place within the home, without which they couldn't exist. They could do nothing while we were rubbing and scrubbing at home. And it began to be in the air, you know, the whole notion of the women's liberation movement. And then I discovered too that a lot of what was preventing women from even going out, there were no proper jobs for women that would bring in a wage. But also the fact that there was no childcare facilities for women who were married and had children. I mean, if you had children and you were unmarried, they didn't want to know you at all. But however, that changed eventually too. But I heard of this FOSS course that was starting up in Marlborough Street in the College of Catering. And it was a year's course, a diploma course, and it was on child caring for anybody interested in taking it up as a job. So I decided to go along and see what that was about. And I did my year and I got my diploma. And it was very interesting, the things that we had people coming in giving us lectures, which was very good, you know, doctors and childcare workers and people who were employed looking after children who were considered to be unmanageable. So we got quite a wide range, wide kind of range of different teaching skills. And then I gradually discovered that women who were working in the trade unions and they were having difficulties in organising creches and things like that. What were they going to do with the children? Nobody to look after the children. Of course, none of the men ever had that problem. And it only arose because it was the women who wanted to go out and go to conferences and things like that. And this was holding women back. They couldn't achieve any positions in society as long as they were kept back. So I started up this creche, a movable creche that we would take to the various conferences. So any women, like even the Women's Political Association, they used us when they were having their conferences. But it was good as well. Like, it broadened our scope as well, and it was terrific. But unfortunately, when we finished our course, the women had gone off to do various jobs in other areas, some of them emigrated, because the wages for childcare were very, very low. I remember when I was young, it'll just show you how people regarded children and those who looked after them. If a young girl wasn't the brightest star in the heavens and wasn't going to get a job, even a job in a factory that anyone could do, they'd say, she can get a job looking after children. The result was that I had young girls who needed looking after themselves being put in charge of looking after young children. And that's what it was like when I was growing up. And that's the attitude that they had towards women. She's only good enough for looking after children. It's a terrible thing. I think that it's not been understood enough that they should have proper training and proper facilities for childcare workers, and proper wages. They need to be organised. And this is what the group that I was training with tried to do. We did organise ourselves as the Association of Preschool Workers. And unfortunately, since our training only went on for a year, we dispersed after the year and people got different jobs. Some of them emigrated and we just didn't get together. It didn't work out. But as long as women don't have the opportunities to go to work, leave the children with trained people who will look after them properly, you won't get women going back to work. One of the things that we tried to do is we got in touch with the banks, we got in touch with various organisations, we sent them letters and we said that if you have women with children who find it difficult. Some of the women, and this is true, and I'm sure it's still the same, would have to get the children up at about 6 o'clock in the morning, get them washed, dressed, fed, and bring them with them to the place where the creche or the community playgroup, wherever they were. And little babies shouldn't be taken up like that. Taken out of their beds at that hour of the morning. There should be facilities for women to come in at a certain hour, give them time to get their children together at a reasonable hour to leave them in the creches. Or else we wanted workplace facilities for them. Then a lot of people didn't like that because they didn't want to bring their children to where they were working. And the bosses didn't like it because they were saying that the women would be called away from their jobs and have to look after whatever child was sick or whatever. But it can be done, and you just have to get people to sit down and talk about it, discuss it, and see to it, because it's a very important thing if we're going to improve society and improve the lot of women, their lot of women. I mean, not lots of women, but the lot of women. Women have to be able to get up and go to work, just like any man going to work. He leaves everything behind him and he goes to work. He isn't thinking about the children. So there has to be something done. People would have to realise that it's not just the job of women, mothers, to bring up their children. It's a family thing. And men will have to be prepared to do that. And until you get that, you won't get equality. Public.
Okay, Max?
Yeah. I'm just laughing. For anybody that doesn't realise that Maureen's here beside me at the moment, and we've just been laughing at her expose there on equality, and no better woman to say it. And what's frightening is when you listen to what she has to say, there's a lot of things that haven't changed still. So I really feel that, you know, we should be using those kind of videos for younger women to understand that the struggles that we had are still the struggles that they have, and for them to identify with it, you know. Very important, obviously, that when we're talking about women here today, and the next piece is the wonderful Neve Parsons, who is very involved with the Musicians Union, as some of you will know. And I was recently doing some work with her on a fundraiser on Gaza. So a woman that's very committed to the trade union movement. And actually, I'm just looking at Catherine Ann there and remembering that Catherine Ann works with me on Gaza Kids. So there seems to be tie-ups here. Maybe it's just something to do with women and work and unions. But anyway, the wonderful Neve Parsons is going to finish this piece by singing Bread and Roses.
As we go marching, marching in the beauty of the day, a million darkened kitchens, a thousand mill lofts grey, are touched with all the radiance that the sudden sun discloses. For the people hear us singing bread and roses, bread and roses. As we come marching, marching, we battle too for men, for they are women's children, and we mother them again. Our lives shall not be sweated from birth until life closes. Hearts starve as well as bodies. Give us bread, but give us roses. As we come marching, marching, unnumbered women dead go crying through their singing their ancient call for bread. Small art and love and beauty, their drudging spirits knew. Yes, it is bread we fight for, but we fight for roses too. As we go marching, marching, we bring the greater days. For the rising of the women means the rising of the race. No more the drudge and idler, tend that toil where one reposes, but a sharing of life's glories, bread and roses, bread and roses. Yes, a sharing of life's glories, bread and roses, bread and roses.
Now, isn't that something very appropriate?
You're okay, Max, go ahead. Yeah,
I said, isn't that something very appropriate to end that segment on? You know, and women fighting for bread, but fighting for roses too. I just want to pick up as well, and because we're going into the launch of the book now, but I just thought it was very appropriate when Maureen was talking earlier, and I could just envisage her going in to see into the union offices, and it's just that the thoughts of her, and when you think that Helen Shelvinix is actually mentioned in the book, and there she was with Louis Bennett and Helen Shelvinix, so it's a lovely tie-in of the past and bringing us back to the book. So appropriate as well, because this book is really about, you know, it's, if you like, unfinished revolution, and the suffragettes that are, you know, mentioned in the beginning of this book, and that's where Catherine will come in, because she has a wonderful rap on Hannah Shee Skeffington. So take it away there, Catherine.
Hello. Well, this is great to be part of this wonderful event. I'm really enjoying it. Thanks to everybody. So this is really just a bit of fun that I wrote, a rap inspired by the plaque at Dublin Castle to Hannah Shee Skeffington. In English, the plaque says that Hannah smashed these windows, but the Irish is much more evocative. In Irish, it says it commemorates Hannah a rinna smiderini dina fuinioga sho, who made smithereens of these windows. And that phrase I just thought just had to be in a rap. And so here it is. And feel free to join in the chorus, which is Arina Smiderini Dina Fuinioga Sho. Arina Smiderini Dina Fuinioga Sho. Okay, so it's called Smiderini or Smithereens Rap. The surface tension shatters when you rock it with a whack, like up in Dublin Castle where they hammered up a plaque, when the city gave its benison to Hannah Shee Skeffington, a rinna smiderini dina fuinioga sho, a rinna smiderini dina fuinioga sho. For the swift emancipation of the women of the nation and the self-determination of the country that she loved. Though jailed for being a menace in the castle, here's to Skeffington, a rinna smiderini dina fuinioga sho, a rinna smiderini dina fuinioga sho. More revolting, more repealing, ni fader de la rash. Chip away the crystal ceiling, that's a window we must smash. By subverting, not submission, we'll honour the tradition. A rinna smiderini dina fuinioga sho, a rinna smiderini dina fuinioga sho. The smasher at the castle never gave in to fatigue, from the Women Workers' Union to the Women's Franchise League. Remember the resistors, it was Hannah and her sisters, Arina Smiderini Dina Fuinioga Sho, Arina Smiderini Dina Fuinioga Sho. Sinead.
That's wonderful, thanks for that, Catherine. Kate, you might move on now to the actual launch of Left Lives for the Women.
Welcome to the launch of the 15th title from Almost Compress. The current title, Left Lives in 20th Century Ireland, Volume 4, Women, is edited by Mags O'Brien. It's a series of 10 essays on what are described by a number of the authors and the editor as the three phases of Irish feminism, and it covers a period of 135 years right up to date. Mags is going to talk about the authors, her role as editor, and she's also an author of associated with three of the essays. The Left Live series and the centenary essays in relation to William Walker constitute nearly 1,200 pages of script and photographs. And the idea of Left Lives in 20th Century Ireland was based upon a premise of icons of the left in 20th Century Ireland, which name transmuted into Left Lives. And the idea was that it was felt in a number of conversations with people around labour history and around trade union lives that not enough of the ordinary men and women who were associated with these campaigns were really replicated in history. And the idea was that we should give voice to these people. And so Francis Devine and myself edited volume one and volume two. And then Francis and Patrick Smiley did a volume at the very start of the pandemic in April 2020 on communist lives, which was quite a big tome, 20 essays about people in the communist movement, which had a significant number of women portrayed in it. But following those three publications, I had a long look at what we'd done. And it was very obvious that still, even though we had portrayed a number of women, we hadn't really given them what I would call equality of coverage. So it was felt by Umskin Press that it was important that we should redress that imbalance at that time by having a volume solely on women, and that it should be edited by a woman or women. And so I approached Mags O'Brien, and she volunteered to do the job. I think it's fair to say Mags probably didn't know what it was going to be like to edit a volume in pandemic Ireland, and some of the issues that came up, which Mags will talk about, specifically the fact that there are still a number of institutions which are repositories for documents which are not open to people. And that gave us a bit of an issue. However, we got on with the job. That there's a very interesting array of people. And I suppose one of the most important things in terms of Left Lives is the fact that it's not just his history, it's history in the making, in that there are three people portrayed in this book who are still alive. The 90-year-old Maureen Johnston, the 80-plus Mary Marr, and our colleague from Northern Ireland who's in our mid-60s. And the fact is that we portray women from Scotland, Northern Ireland, and the Republic. And I think there's a good geographic spread. I think it's important in this day and age that these type of books, and the organization that I run is not a commercial publisher per se, it's a not-for-profit organization. So whatever money we get from set books goes back into the next production. And given we go on our 15th publication, I'm happy to say that hopefully for the near future, there are more books to be considered. In writing the introduction to Left Lives 4, looking at what we've done, it's obvious that there is at least one more volume on women to be written. And we'll have to talk to people about that in relation to the future profile of Umskin Press. There are a number of projects that have been paused because they rely on trade union conferences to actually be in being. Trade union conferences and a few commercial booksellers and the Umskin Press website, www.umskinpress.wordpress.com, is where you can order the book. So I'd like to thank the authors, and in particular Mags O'Brien, for the sterling work that she did for Umskin Press. I'd also like to thank Christy Hammond and his colleagues in CRM Design and Print in relation to, we probably cut it a bit tight to make sure that we would get the thing covered in the event. And finally, I'm glad to say, given that this launch has been run in conjunction with the 110th anniversary of the Irish Women Workers Union, that on page Roman 10, we have a dedication to the Irish Women Workers Union, which also has a something from the Larkin's newspaper, and something, the badge of the Irish Women Workers Union in Irish, and a flag from the Irish Women Workers Union, which has been on display over the last number of years in Liberty Hall at various celebrations, including the Lockout and the 1916 centenary celebrations. They're important, and resides normally in the Irish Labour History Society as well. I'd also like to thank my colleague Ed Penrose in the Irish Labour History Society for giving Mags and some of the other people access to papers. And of course, the majority of the records for the Irish Women Workers Union are actually held in the Irish Labour History Society. So without further ado, we'll say that the book is in being now. And I hope you enjoy it, and I'd be glad to receive any comments that people have. So over to you, Mags.
Thanks, Jack. First of all, I want to welcome everyone, especially contributors and friends and lovers of history, or in this case, her story. While I have an overwhelming feeling of relief that Left Eyes For has finally been published, I'm delighted that I got to connect or reconnect with some wonderful people along the way. I do want to thank all the authors who were absolutely a joy to work with, despite the fact that all of us were trying to negotiate a strange world and some were dealing with illnesses or personal losses. They delivered wonderful work that breathes life and colour into the stories we wanted to tell. There were more wonderful women who we hoped to cover, but life got in the way. They deserve to have their stories told too. And as Jack says, perhaps we should look at that. What I'm really happy to do is, as Jack was saying, that there are people who are still alive that we covered in the book. And, you know, you get a much richer flavor if you can talk to people like that. It's been a privilege to work with people I've always admired, such as academic historians Margaret Ward and Mary McAuliffe, and equally respected journalists Seamus Dooley and Catherine Johnson, and Labour historians Francis Devine and Charles Callan, and my friend and colleague Kate Kerwin. I must also thank the publisher, Jack McGinley, for suggestions, proof and forbearance with my tendency to stray from the style guide. And thanks also to John Swift for his work on the index. The women covered in this book are very varied, but there's a common thread that runs through it all. Helen Shevenick's and Margaret Skinner, they were both suffragists, but Shevenick's was a pacifist and Skinner fought at the College of Surgeons in 1916. But they both fought tirelessly within the trade union movement for equality. The second wave of feminism then saw women like Evelyn Owens, Mary Marr, Padraigín na Moricu, Maureen Johnson, May O'Brien and Dimfna Harper continue to fight, some of them being more high profile than others, but all of them were equally committed to the fight for equality. And again, all were trade union activists. Meanwhile, in the Northern jurisdiction, women like Monica McWilliams had to face not just a patriarchy, but a sectarian one. And yet the Women's Coalition bravely played a role in Northern politics. And that was a pivotal role. The final chapter is devoted to Lyra McKee, another feminist fighter who promised to be another star, but was cruelly cut down. I think it's worth referring back to the Irish, the ICTU Women's Charter of the 70s, which demanded the Irish Congress of Trade Unions recognises and demands the right of everyone, irrespective of race, ethnic origin, creed, political opinion, age, sex, or marital status, to have the means to pursue their economic independence and to full participation in the social, cultural, and political life of the community in conditions of freedom, dignity, and equal opportunity. But despite many campaigns, we're still light years away from these most reasonable demands. And women are still bearing the brunt, as Ethel has already said, of childcare and family care. And there are still few cracks in those glass ceilings in most workplaces. Undoubtedly, the women's liberation movement of the 1970s and the existence of the Congress Women's Advisory Committee was an exciting and invigorating time for women, and great gains were made and some crack was had. But progress has slowed and another new wave is needed. Of course, sisters in the Northern jurisdiction deserve special mention here as well, as their battles still are not just with the patriarchy, but also a sectarian legal system that they had to fight for basic civil rights. Mary McAuliffe writes about the difficulty of obtaining sources when researching the lives of women in history. And as Jack said, this was doubly influenced by the pandemic. I was shocked when I was writing the chapter in Left Lives 2 on Sylvia Meehan to find that many years on, records on notable women are still scant. Fortunately, I was able to breathe life into the chapter by speaking to her family and her contemporaries. That experience gave me the resolve to record stories and recollections from some of the wonderful women I've been privileged to know over the years. Some of them are covered in this volume and are either still here to tell their tale, or their friends and colleagues can give us their recollections and reflections. There's something very satisfying about being able to check a chapter with its subject. Of course, tapes may sometimes have to be edited. That's another tale. When I reflect on my many years in the labour and trade union movement, I feel anger, real anger, that despite many promises, it's not delivered more for women. But until we proportionately populate the union executives and the exalted office spaces, we will always be told that though we have just cause, we must wait until the pandemic or the next recession is over for our agenda to be addressed. Women remembered here knew that their fight was in the present, not in some idealized future. La lucha continua.
That's pretty good. Well done, Max.
Is Jack something?
I'd like to call on Deputy General Secretary Ethel Buckley to formally launch Left Lives in 20th Century Ireland Women.
Thanks very much, Jack. And thanks to you, Mags, as well, for that wonderful introduction to this fabulous book. I received the book a number of days ago, and I really haven't put it down since. It's a very accessible book to read, which I appreciate, because as Jack said, one of the goals of Umuskan in this series, I believe, is to record the lives of people who have contributed to the trade union movement, to the labour movement, to the women's movement, who may not have been the leaders with their names up in lights, but made very significant contributions that would not be recorded for future generations if this series didn't exist. And that is why I appreciate so much that the language and the style of the book is so accessible, because I hope to see this book in the hands of activists throughout the trade union movement. Obviously, it's going to be a really important reference point for researchers and for academics. But where I would love to see the book is in the hands of shop stewards and workplace activists around the country who build this movement that we are all so committed to and inspired by. And particularly for women activists in the movement to read this book would be tremendous, I feel. There is that kind of slogan in feminism that if you can't see it, you can't be it. And that's why I think it is so important that women shop stewards who do still face structural barriers to their activism in the trade union movement, unfortunately, and along with Mags, that makes me angry too. Those structural barriers are some of the structural barriers are still there today that the women in this book experienced and that the authors have chronicled here. So for that reason, I think it will inspire trade union activists, and I really encourage people to buy the book and to read the book, because to be a trade union activist, and particularly to be a woman activist in the trade union movement, it takes quite a bit of courage. And what you will get from the pages of this book is you will be equipped with examples of women who, against the odds, stood up and demanded that their voice was heard, and stood up often in difficult circumstances, and were really courageous in ensuring that they weren't talked down. There's a fabulous, the very start of the book actually has a fabulous description of Helen Shenovic speaking at a conference and the way that she approached the heckling crowd that she was facing when she went up to the rostrum. And I think, look, Jack was talking about the importance of conferences to Omiskin, but the importance of conferences to the trade union movement and to people finding their voice and finding their activism can't be understated. And I know that every activist, but particularly women activists, that first time you go up to the rostrum and have your voice heard at a union conference is a real moment. And often in our lives of activism or our actual paid lives in the trade union movement, you have to summon courage to make the contributions that are required at the time to ensure that women have their place in our movement and that we defend the rights of women in our workplace. I know that I often have to take a deep breath and summon that steel rod down my back in the movement and when I'm dealing with employers. And this book will just remind me, as I said at the start, that we're standing on the shoulders of giants, that we are the inheritors of this incredible, rich tradition of brave and formidable and smart and strategic and tactical women. And we need to know their stories. We need to take inspiration from their stories. We need to take courage from their stories. So I commend the authors for the chapters in this book. I commend Mags for her work as editor. I think it must have been a difficult job for her to choose the subjects of the chapters. And I'm really glad to hear you talking that there might be another volume, so we'll have more of these lives to draw upon. And I thank and commend Jack for the not-for-profit Umskin, which is playing a really important role in the trade union movement in recording these lives. This is the fourth volume now, and I commend all of the volumes which I have read. And if you wish to purchase them, as Jack said there, you can just go to the website. So finally, and with great pride and honour, I want to welcome this book to our movement and to thank you and all of the authors for it, and to formally launch Left Lives in the 20th Century, the volume on women. Thank you both.
Thanks very much for that, Ethel. Really delighted now to have formally launched the book. There's a few thank yous, obviously. Some of the people that were participated today, Catherine and Niamh and Aoife, who made the video of Maureen at short notice, and to the comms in Liberty Hall but very much so to Kate and her colleagues who put the video together for us and looked after the presentations today. So I just, before we finish, I just want to know if anybody wants to ask particular questions, or there's been some lovely commentary running through here. And, you know, we're delighted to hear from people who knew everybody. It's just, what would you say? It's just, yeah, I'm just seeing Seamus there saying the most indulgent editor. I don't think indulgent is probably the proper word for it. somebody who disregarded all the style notices, etc. But I think when, you know, if you read the book, you'll find that there are different styles in it, but it's really important that there are. And I feel that when you're writing about, you know, fabulous women, that you don't just use ordinary style language. You have to go outside the box. And there's some funny stories in here as well. I mean, I was skittin' laughing at Maureen's video there, but anybody that knows Maureen knows that she really and truly, you know, when you're in her company, those are the kind of comments. And my comment about the video, by the way, or the tapes, was initially when I was doing the chapter on Maureen, I did a few interviews with her and typed the tapes, and I just laughed till I cried. But unfortunately, some of it couldn't be actually put in the book. It might be for another time, another place. And I think I'm looking at Des there. I can see Des in the picture there. You know, Des, you would have known some of the families involved and some of the crack that was involved. And maybe you might write that book rather than me writing that book. So over to anybody, if anybody wants to come in. No, I think everybody's quiet enough. Of course, I didn't say thanks to Dr. Jack. Obviously, we wouldn't be here if we didn't have Almost Compress. And, you know, he's done great work on that. So maybe that's an opportune thanks to have at the end. Okay, everybody, unless there's anything in the chat room. No, I think everybody's happy. And it was lovely to see some of the faces as well here today. I've been missing a lot of people through COVID, and it's really nice to actually see that people are beginning to surface anyway. So thanks to you all, and have a good evening. Cheers.
Thanks, Mags.
Just trying to read the commentary.